Of all the people who are changing Britain today, our strength is that there are no two the same. In the brouhaha of the London Motor Show, the public can renew its love affair with the motor car. They come to see the new thing in body shapes, to pick out this year's status symbol, to find the new British fuel injection engine, the Italian competitor in the minicar stakes, and to gaze enviously on the young men's sports cars. They like the gloss and glamour, the super salesmen, and the girls. The public comes for the bright lights and the luxurious feeling of being wooed. The motor industry is there on business. The industry must do its deals and sell, sell, sell. And one man must do his deals on a bigger scale than anyone else. Lord Stokes of British Leyland Motor Corporation, who dominates the motor show by being half of all Britain's car production. He got there by an amazing merger in which his small motor company took over the biggest British car manufacturer. The minnow swallowed the whale. And now British Leyland produces one out of every two cars made in Britain and has a turnover of nearly £1,000,000. He has probably the toughest job of any boss in Britain, and the most important, because British Leyland is Britain's biggest exporter. Lord Stokes is out for those overseas buyers at the motor show. He's a salesman, by intellect as well as instinct.
Well, Walter, we've got to do something about increasing our market penetration in Switzerland. You're selling 16,000 cars this year, which is pretty good, but we've got to beat Volkswagen and these other people. We're doing, what, about 9% of the market, is it?
We're doing now exactly 903% of the market, and as you already said, with this new centralization of your production capacity, I believe it is possible to have a better penetration and to sell next year about 18,000 cars. And the goal is to beat Volkswagen, that's the truth.
I think we've got to get some, I know we're doing quite a lot, but we've got to do more on this. If we get more of a team of trucks going out, have a circus or something like this, you know, so that we can show the whole range and get people interested and take it along to each little canton and say, these are the cars, the small cars, the medium-sized cars, the big cars, and then the trucks and the buses. We've got the whole lot, we've got the whole umbrella, we can beat the world.
As a small boy, I was attracted to motor vehicles, particularly buses. I used to find every opportunity of playing around in the bus garage and got interested in them, and they had Leyland buses, it so happened, and I made up my mind at a very early age that that's where I wanted to go to work. I think I had one of the happiest periods of my life there, and I think I learned a lot about buses and trucks. And from that, I passed the necessary exams and got my engineering qualifications and went into the engineering department of the firm as a technical assistant to the chief technical officer of the company.
Lord Stokes joined Leyland because he found engineering exciting, and it still excites him. This plant is producing the chassis of the famous London bus.
Let's have a look at the chassis for London Transport.
Part of Lord Stokes' success has been due to his ability to understand the problems of the shop floor.
Tell me, how's this distributor pump getting on now? Is it better than the inline pump?
Yes, much better now. It's coming along fine.
Is it easier to connect up than the other, or is there any difference?
No, it's but easier now. There's no vibration trouble at all with them now.
Well, it's a much more efficient proposition, I think, than the inline.
Much easier.
Cheaper anyway, but
yes.
Something. Fine,
better.
Thank you.
Well, they're all going to be changed, are they?
They're going to be changed. They're coming through rather slowly at the moment.
How many is it that we've done now, John? How many altogether?
450.
And there's another order coming for what?
Another 400.
And you've got some big export orders, haven't you?
Oh, yes.
And how many a week can we do of these at a maximum? We get some more orders.
Well, we're a little limited, but we could build this up. The capacity at the moment is 12 a week.
At this particular model, this factory.
We've already told London Transport we can build it up if need be.
These chassis that are going for export have got special cooling, is that right?
Yes, we've had to augment the cooling. There's been a fair bit of work done on that.
And didn't Keith Roberts, he went over to investigate this himself in one of these Middle East countries to check the cooling?
Yes, he's been in the Middle East on this subject, yes.
Now, what about this fluorescent lighting so people can read a newspaper easily?
Yes, this is the alternator system.
Now, what about this? Tell me what this is for. This is something new to me. What's this we've got on here?
It's a test bridge. It just tests that the air on the brakes is on the working properly.
Oh, I see.
If it's not working well, it shows up on the light.
Oh, I get. Well, what's this 2-1 for? This pushes it over, does it? From one to the other.
That's right. Just a 2-1, 2-2.
My word, it's getting complicated, more complicated every day, isn't it?
Yes. Thank you.
Lord Stokes has been making cars all his life, except for the period of the Second World War. He came back from the army with his master plan for building up Leyland, which was then still a small truck and bus company.
It seemed to me if we were going to survive at Leyland, we had to expand. I prepared a plan of what I thought Leyland should do, and when the war was over, I went back and said, here's what I think you should do, and they read it, and they said, well, if that's what you think, you can join us tomorrow and start doing it. And that's how it happened, and we built this plan up for expanding Leyland. Had tremendous cooperation from Sir Henry Spurrier, who was the chairman of the company. We implemented it by expanding all over the world. We decided that we had to sell half of everything we made overseas. We acquired Albion Lorries, which was a Scottish company, to increase our production. We then acquired Scammell Lorries, who make heavy tank transporters and big machinery movers. After that, we found that even we built up a huge, relatively huge overseas organization, but we had not enough to sell and more people overseas to sell it. So we looked around to see what else we could do, and the obvious thing to do was to sell motor cars. And we approached Standard Triumph, and they weren't very interested in the first instance. They thought they could manage themselves. And then on the selling side, and then we thought, well, if that's how they feel, we better put a bid in and buy the whole company. And so we bought up Standard Triumph, and from that we progressed by various degrees and eventually landed up acquiring BMC and the lot, and now we account for half the British motor industry.
Lord Stokes has realized his dream of bringing all British car manufacture into one corporation. His natural style is that of the old-fashioned paternalistic boss, driving, encouraging, exhorting. But he's realistic enough to know that in a company this size, each division has to operate independently. The car, bus, and truck people make their own decisions, and Lord Stokes checks that their plans fit his overall policy.
Now, what about these CKD chassis? Can we increase the number of CKD chassis for export?
We are aiming to get at 60 a week.
What about, this is a South Wales Transport, that's English one, that one,
this vehicle, yes.
Now, these are the South African type, that's South African. Yes. And this is a Portuguese.
That's the Portuguese one.
How are these Portuguese people getting on today who are here? They play some very substantial
orders. Very substantial orders. They are fourth biggest importers in the country.
And the vehicle's all right, it's the right type of vehicle.
Oh, yes, well, they take the right across the line, all types of vehicles, passenger and goods.
Now, these are the Saudi Arabian type.
That's the Saudi Arabian type.
They're getting ready for this big contract for Libya.
Yes, that's the big contract we're doing there.
Good. That's fine. Well, I think we've got to get this export up, this CKD side.
That vehicle has just been prepared
for the Brussels show.
It's almost impossible to tell which car one likes most or gets most emotional about. Sports cars have a tremendous fascination because, take an E-Type Jaguar or something like that, it's got a tremendous fun appeal about it. On the other hand, if you get something like the Mini, which is really an absolute winner and goes on and on and on, I think one categorizes them in different aspects. And really what I do all the time is you keep on looking where some horrible competitor has built one which you think is a bit too good, and you start worrying about what you've got to beat him. And this, of course, is what makes the business so fascinating. I started off as an engineer. I suppose I am an engineer. I've forgotten most of it now. But I always felt there was very little point in making something unless you could sell it. And I also felt that one of the more interesting things was meeting people, traveling, getting to know what was happening and what was going on, and trying to get this translated back into something that was built. I get a tremendous personal kick out of getting an order. I think this is a terrific challenge to meet somebody and to be able to persuade them to buy something, sometimes something they don't even want, which is even more satisfactory. Well, I remember when I was younger, trying to sell something, it's a bit of an effort, you know. You go to a country with a just your, you land at the airport with a suitcase, you go to, I don't know, Colombia if you like, or from any South American republic, anywhere you like in the world. You don't know a soul there, no one's ever heard of your product, and you've got to go in cold and you've got to persuade somebody to like what you make and to buy it. And in some cases I found, for instance, you don't know anybody who's going to buy something, but I keep on telling my chaps, in our business you can always sell something, because if you just get a taxi and follow a lorry until it comes to its garage, the chap there's a potential customer, so you can make a start.
Back at the motor show, stunts and gimmicks are the order of the day. It's all legitimate if it gets the attention of the press. And Lord Stokes himself rarely refuses an interview if it will provide the company with publicity.
The Continentals, you see, have brought in the two cheapest cars in the show, haven't they?
Yes, but I'm not
the
sure.
The Italian one and the French one.
Yeah, but they're not always right.
You don't think they're
right?
No.
Cliff Michelmore is a famous BBC commentator and almost a national institution. The BBC itself is a highly independent television network and expects its men to be quite ruthless in questioning even someone as eminent as Lord Stokes. Michelmore warns him of what's coming.
You'll be on one side, I shall be on the other. We'll talk about that. And then I really want you to look ahead. Do you think there are better times ahead? Because you've had a bad patch for about 4 or 5 years. The whole of the car industry has had a bad patch. You know, even when you launched the Maxi, it didn't go quite as well, or it didn't come on the market at the right time, you know.
Well, it came just when it came tumbling down.
Yeah, you know. How far do you think people are put off by sort of garage bills and warranty claims and things like this? Do you think this really puts them off motor cars? Buying a motor car?
I don't think anything puts people off motor cars. I think the sheer joy of possession is above everything else.
Can we have you standing in, sir? Just there. Thank you.
No, that's true. Lord Stokes, why are fewer people buying motor cars these days?
Well, at the present moment, it's only in the United Kingdom. You've got to remember that our output of cars has gone up by 7.5% over the previous year. We made 1,055,000 cars. We've got two good balance of payments months. I mean, we mustn't get too excited about this, but I'm quite sure that certainly by next spring the market will expand, and we're going to have an absolute boom year next year. So if you want to buy a car, buy it now before the tremendous rush next year.
You're doing a motor show sales talk, you see. Nevertheless, 10% of people in this country are buying foreign cars now, aren't they?
Of course they are, and I'm not worried about this. It's quite right. We export 50% of all the cars we make. We've got to be big-hearted and let 10% come into the country. I mean, this is good for us, and it's good to show how good our cars are in comparison with some of the foreign stuff that comes in.
Yeah. Do you think, though, the British motor car industry really is prepared to change enough? Because going round here, there are remarkably few new-looking cars. They change the doors, they change the wheels, they change the engine a little bit. The only new cars one gets really are from abroad. Really,
oh,
you look.
Really, I don't know how you
come
can
on.
Say that.
Yes,
look,
no.
First of all, changing a car like this costs millions just to change the styling on the front of it. You've got a new Triumph over there, which is a completely rehashed Triumph. We've got petrol injection, which is the first in a production car. We've got the new Daimler. We've got the new Jaguar. We're constantly producing innovations. I think we're amongst the leaders in the car industry in this world. But I can show you one or two foreign makes here that have never changed for 30 years.
You're back at being the super optimist again, aren't you, though, really?
Well, it's about time. We had some super optimists in this country. This country, basically and economically, is all right. We're just on the edge of a seesaw. We've only just got a few more paces to go, and we're home and dry, and we're well away.
What we better do now is we better take you up to the office and sign next year's contract whilst it's fresh in your mind. You see, for cars, trucks and buses, the whole lot. And then that'll give you a spur.
If the price is right, okay.
Oh, let's go.